He is an author of more than 80 articles and reviews in popular and academic journals in Europe and North America. He is currently at work on a manuscript tentatively entitled Sexual Differentiation in the Christian East, Ancient Sources, Ancient and Modern. He is the editor of Logos, a journal of Eastern Christian Studies, the only Eastern Catholic theological journal in North America. He is an ordained subdeacon in the Ukrainian Greco-Catholic Church, the largest of the Eastern churches in communion with Rome. He is married to Anne Marie, with whom he has two sons and a daughter born in May of this year. And he is a great colleague in addition to our department and teaches many fine classes. So I'd like to introduce to you Dr. Adam DeVille.
Thanks, David. So there was a man who had a theological question, and he couldn't find an answer, so he went and talked to the Pope. He said, Holy Father, I'm completely addicted to golf. I'm a fanatic about golf. I play golf every day. I love golf. And over the years, I've asked priests and theologians and bishops, is there going to be golf in heaven? Nobody can answer that question for me. So I've come to you. You're my last hope to give me an answer to this question. Is there golf in heaven? Are there golf courses in heaven where I can play when I die? And so the Pope says, well, you know, I've got a regularly scheduled phone call with God tomorrow, so I will ask him then, and I'll get back to you. And so Pope talks to God the next day and then calls up Joe. Says, Joe, there's good news and there's bad news. The good news is God says there are more golf courses than you can possibly count in heaven, and they're more beautiful and more challenging than anything you can imagine on earth. He says, oh, that's great. I'm so relieved. What's the bad news? He says, you tee off tomorrow. The popes and the papacy, as we're going to see tonight, very long-standing institution, some very serious aspects about it, but not without some rather amusing, occasionally humorous aspects to it as well. What I want to do tonight is basically help to do a number of things. First is kind of to borrow a phrase from the Protestant theologian Stanley Hauerwas, clear the swamp a little bit, because there are any number of misconceptions about who the Pope is, the papal office or the papacy, and the Vatican, a place of great intrigue and mystery. So we want to spend some time clearing away some of the larger, more common misconceptions. We could spend all night doing that, because there are many. But we're not going to do that. We're just going to cover, I hope, some of the main ones to try and clear up some of that. Having done that, then there are three, in fact, distinct institutions that I want to take a look at and help us understand what is what and which institution does what. The Pope, the papacy or the papal office itself, and then Vatican City State, to look at all three of those. And the Holy See as well, within that configuration. And having narrowed our focus to look at the Pope and the papacy, what I want to do after that is then broaden our focus and end on kind of a wider note, and to look a little bit at some wider ecclesiological questions, that is, questions about the nature of the Church, so that we don't forget that ultimately the papacy, the Vatican, is an instrument of service to the Church. It exists for no reason other than that, and so to ask some questions about the nature of the Church. And then spend as much time as you want on questions and discussion, which I always find oftentimes the most profitable aspect of any kind of presentation. So if you've got questions and comments you want to make, I hope you won't be shy in sharing those. So the first question, you know, why would you come out to a presentation like this tonight? What's the relevance of talking about the papacy, about the Pope, and about the Vatican and the Holy See? It seems to me there are two fairly immediate answers to that question. One pertains to the authority the office is capable of exercising, the authority by which it commands the allegiance of more than 1 billion Catholics in the world today, making it the largest single religious institution in the world. That's not a kind of number that I think we can lightly dismiss, given the size of the Catholic Church. The other is the antiquity of the office. The papacy, in fact, is the longest-serving continuous instrument of governance in the Western world. It antedates all of the crowned heads of Europe, you know, the Romanovs and the Windsors and the Habsburgs, all of the polities of Western Europe, of North America, all of the constitutions of France and Britain and the United States. All of those are but infants compared to the antiquity of the papacy. There's a very famous essay published in the late 19th century by Thomas Babington Macaulay, who was not a Catholic, but he was reviewing a very famous 40-volume history of the papacy by Ludwig Pasteur. And in his review, Macaulay spoke of the papacy in the following terms. He says, "The proudest royal houses are but of yesterday when compared with the line of supreme pontiffs. The papacy remains not in decay, not a mere antique, but full of life and youthful vigor. Nor do we see any sign which indicates that the term of her long dominion is approaching. She saw the commencement of all the governments and all the ecclesiastical establishments that now exist in the world, and we feel no assurance that she is not destined to see the end of them all." So, put less densely, the Pope has been around for a very long time, and for that reason alone, I think it's worth taking a look at this very ancient institution that still exercises such influence in our world today. And we saw that influence 4.5 years ago of the death of Pope John Paul II and the funeral. The top right hand, the crowds lining up for miles and miles down the streets of Rome to get into the piazza down here, and then eventually to get into the basilica, to pass by the bier where the body was laid out. The Swiss guards in charge of security for the papal funeral had it down, I think it was 15 seconds you were allowed. There were that many people. The population of the city of Rome for 10 days more or less doubled from somewhere just under about 2.5 million to almost 5 million people in the course of the 9 days of official mourning set aside by convention, by tradition, for the death of a pope. So the city doubles. 2.5 million people get on planes and trains and buses and walk to go to Rome for a funeral that was the most unique funeral ever. There were more heads of state, heads of government at John Paul's funeral than there have ever been at any comparable gathering in human history. It was an incredible thing to watch. All of the major television networks had already, 10 years beforehand, staked out the best angles, bought airspace on the hotels of surrounding Roman buildings, paid millions and millions of dollars for the rights to cover this funeral of a man who, by most reckoning, was the most recognizable figure of his day, that he had been seen by more crowds, by more people around the world than any other figure. So whether you like the Pope or not, whether you're Catholic or not, whether you think the papacy an institution for good or for ill, it's not something that can simply be ignored. It's not something that can simply be dismissed. It continues to be a very significant player in the world today. Nonetheless, for all of the antiquity, all of the authority, all of the popularity of the office, it also remains one of the most misunderstood in some fairly significant ways. Part of that misunderstanding, as we're going to see, is, I think, the fault of great ignorance and laziness on the part of many commentators about the papacy. But part of it is also, I think we have to be honest with ourselves and say part of it is the result of inadequate formation on the part of Catholics themselves who might not fully understand what exactly the papacy is. I kept a file in April of 2005 during the interregnum, the transition between the death of John Paul and the election of Benedict XVI, of what I called sort of a howler's file of particularly outrageous things that were being said about the Pope, and not in obscure blogs or on somebody's Facebook page, but in mainstream media. It very, very quickly grew to be a very fat file, and I could spend all night unpacking the file here with you, but I just wanted to bring to your attention some of the more outrageous examples of this ignorance that I hope to dispel a little bit tonight. The International Herald Tribune is a paper owned, let us recall, by the New York Times, the so-called newspaper of record, whose self-congratulatory motto is "All the news fit to print," or "All the news we are fit to screw up" in this case. Here we see John Paul laid out on the bier, you know, fairly customary funeral practice. Tucked under his left arm, you can see the silver staff there, which the Herald Tribune called a crow's ear. The proper title, the proper term that we want here is a crozier. We see John Paul in more vigorous days here on the left holding that particular crozier he used, which was a piece of somewhat unfortunate 1970s art that he inherited from Paul VI. The typical crozier of a bishop in the Latin tradition is there in the center. It's a hooked staff. It's reminiscent of, or symbolic, of the staff used by a shepherd to keep his sheep from falling off the cliff or going astray. It's not a crow's ear, it's a crozier. That was just one example. There are some other examples. The BBC. You know, the BBC, the great voice of authority. My grandparents grew up in Britain during the Second World War listening to the BBC. The BBC used to broadcast programs about Latin and the classics. BBC used to be run by people with an education. Here we have the BBC's subtitle service describing a series of nuns that it was videotaping as part of the obsequies for John Paul as Karma Light. This is a series of Carmelite sisters on the left-hand side from here in Indiana. There's a house in Lafayette, I believe it is. They, of course, as we know, their center of focus is Mount Carmel, C-A-R-M-E-L, which is in Haifa in northern modern Israel. It has nothing to do with Far Eastern religious practices, but they couldn't bother themselves to see that. And the chanting of one of the several memorial services for John Paul was done in Latin. Latin is still a recognized language within the Catholic Church, still the official language, in fact. I don't know why that was such a mystery for them. You know, it's in Rome, it's for the Pope. Logically, one could really only conclude that there were two possible contenders for liturgical languages. If it wasn't Latin, it was going to be Italian. Neither of which are that recondite that the BBC could not figure them out, but they didn't even bother to try. Some of the other claims that are out there that we come across, some of them, I have to say, are so tedious that refuting them is really a tiresome exercise, and this is a prime example. But given the popularity of Dan Brown's novel and the film that resulted from it, we probably should comment at least a little bit on this frequent notion that's out there. It just gets repackaged every few years. You know, there's no such thing as a new heresy. They've all been seen before in some form, and they just come back and they get recycled. And so Brown is, in a sense, a kind of a variant of Gnosticism. You know, there is a kind of secret knowledge that has been held or hidden away from people for the better part of 2,000 years, and the church has tried to suppress the real information, you know, the deep, dark, dirty secrets of who Jesus is and his upbringing, and was his mother really a virgin? Did he not, in fact, get married to Mary Magdalene and move to France and have children there? These kind of notions that continue to be recycled. Dan Brown's novel was precisely that. It was a novel. But I was amazed and depressed in about equal measure by the number of people who took it to be some kind of authoritative scholarly text. There was a particularly fatuous fellow interviewed on the front page of the New York Times after having seen the movie when it came out several years ago. And he said, you know, I'm a product of Catholic education. I went to Catholic schools my whole life. I'm 26, and I never heard this before. As though this were something to be taken seriously and not a work of fiction. You know, the idea that things have been withheld, things have been suppressed, things have been twisted, you know, into some kind of politically correct narrative is really quite absurd if you have any idea about how the history of Christianity has come about, or more particularly about how the central organs of the Catholic Church work. They're just simply not capable of that kind of grand deception for all of human history, so that it's left to a contemporary American novelist to somehow discover the truth in the 21st century that's eluded people for centuries before. The coverage of John Paul, you know, if I were a betting man, I could have very quickly become a very rich man, because every story that came across the wire about the funeral invariably had a paragraph in there about the usual issues, the usual sexual issues. Well, John Paul's now dead, and a lot of the media could, I think, hardly disguise their glee at that fact. Many of them had been on a death watch for about 10 years. Finally, they seem to say, we're rid of that retrograde celibate and his horrible antiquated ideas about contraception, abortion, women, and marriage, homosexuality. And maybe we'll get somebody else who'll be more enlightened. Maybe the new pope will be able to change all of these things. One of the variants of that, that John Paul was tarred with and his successor has more recently been tarred with, is this idea that the Catholic position on contraception is somehow responsible for the deaths of millions of people right around the world. This is one of those misrepresentations that is really so illogical that I find it hard to believe that people with functioning brains actually subscribe to it. The lack of logic in this is really quite astonishing. The idea that people who are not Catholic and who would not be inclined to listen to the Pope on larger doctrinal questions on which he is presumed to have some particular expertise would nonetheless listen to the Pope on such an intimate matter as their sexual conduct simply does not make sense. You know, if you're not prepared to follow the Pope on questions of who God is and salvation and sacraments and all that kind of stuff, why would you suddenly feel bound to listen to him when he says contraception is not in keeping with God's plan? It does not make sense. And yet this comes up invariably, and people launch what I think is really a slanderous charge, namely that, well, the Pope is responsible for the deaths of millions because of this position. I really find it hard to believe that people could possibly advance that kind of argument, but it gets recycled quite regularly in the coverage of popes past and present. Now, if I wanted to be really pretentious, I could invent something called, you know, name it after myself, and the law of papal media coverage. And you can see it's a very simple graphic. You can see that. The coverage goes up exponentially insofar as we can somehow tie it in to the so-called pelvic or sexual issues, contraception, abortion, homosexuality, those kinds of things. And if we don't, well, it's not really worth paying attention to, or we really don't know what to do with it. You know, I watched two recent examples of this. When the Pope issued his encyclical just recently on economic questions, you watched many of the media presentations of it really flounder to try and find an angle on this, because there wasn't any sex in it. And isn't that all the Pope talks about? Isn't that what the Pope's obsessed about? You know, so how they really didn't know what to make of this document. And so the coverage was much more muted, much shorter. Many media outlets simply ignored it. And you could get a very palpable sense that they were just kind of bewildered by this. You know, well, why is he talking about this? You know, isn't he supposed to be talking about sex? And then the events of this week, which we'll come back to a little later, in the very astonishing overtures made towards Episcopalians and Anglicans. Some of the coverage of the press conference in Rome 2 days ago had the same kind of thing. You know, well, how can we kind of spin this according to our usual categories and see, you know, what are the implications for the issues that we're really interested in as media? This is one of the favorites. This is a very old idea that has been around for quite a long time. This is from an editorial cartoon in Australia in 2007. And this is, of course, the idea that to think with the church really means that you don't, in fact, think. You're kind of a slavish, robotic sort of figure who simply does what you're told. This is another very silly notion for several reasons. Again, for people who have a passing interest or knowledge of history, in the West, who set up the universities? Who established the universities of Paris and Bologna and Oxford and Cambridge and some of the other great universities? The Catholic Church did. You know, if the Catholic Church were afraid of knowledge, afraid of study, afraid of questions, of debate, we wouldn't have established universities. We would have, at best, set up kind of catechetical schools or seminaries or just propaganda institutes and not encouraged the development of the mind that has been done in Christian universities for more than 1,000 years. The other problem with this notion is that, in addition to just being simply incorrect, it forgets that the notion that you're beholden to a tradition is a notion that you find in all disciplines. You're not free to set yourself up as a biology professor and teach whatever you feel like, and call it science, call it biology. You're not free to set yourself up at any reputable institution and say, you know, the Holocaust never happened. That's an invention. You're not free to do that. You're not free to set yourself up as a scholar of any discipline and make things up. You're indebted to, you're beholden to, you're shaped by, you're accountable to other people within your discipline and within the academic world at large. And it's the same with theology. You're not free to just make things up and call them Catholic theology. In the same way, you're not free to make things up and call it scientific biology or zoology or any of the other particular disciplines. And this idea that people are free to think for themselves is really one of the silliest ideas that's out there. The great Duke Methodist theologian Stanley Harrow says, you know, this idea that people should think for themselves is a lie, and you can prove that it's a lie by asking them one simple question. Who taught you that? Who taught you to think for yourself? You had to learn it from somebody. It didn't just occur to you magically or miraculously. You're beholden to somebody. Somebody has taught you that. That's what you're supposed to do. And that, of course, as Harrow would say, and people like the moral philosopher Alistair MacIntyre, is a unique idea of liberal modernity. It's not an idea that most people have, until this period of history, actually taken seriously. And the problem with this idea, MacIntyre would say, is that it disguises precisely how much you are indebted to a particular tradition of thought. In this case, kind of the liberal individualism and emotivism of the modern period. Some of the other ideas that you hear, there was a YouTube clip just about 10 days ago that was recycling this one and saying, you know, if the Pope wants to be taken seriously, then he needs to sell everything he's got. Several things that nobody bothers to remember here. First of all, sell it to whom? Who has the kind of money to buy things like manuscripts that are 5, 8, 1,000 years old? Who has the kind of money? What are you going to do? You're going to go in and buy the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel and what? Take it down and move it to your private house? Who, apart from maybe a dozen people in the world, has that kind of money? But leaving that question aside, is it even possible to put a price on these things? How do you value things that have been around for centuries, things that are part of the culture and the history of the entire Western world? The other thing that people overlook here is that no institution in the world does more for the poor than the Catholic Church. And that's not apologetic propaganda I'm feeding you. That's a simple demonstrable fact that you can verify for yourselves. No other institution in the world today provides more health care and more education and more services for the poor around the world than the Catholic Church. So the idea that the church is somehow a big fat cat sitting on all these things while the world's peasants starve is simply not borne out by the facts. Nobody does more. Could the church do more? Absolutely. Could Catholics do more? Absolutely. But the idea that we're not already doing more than anybody else is simply not borne out by the truth. The final thing that people who make this argument don't consider is the very famous statement of the greatest Russian novelist of the 19th century, Fyodor Dostoevsky. The world, he said, will be saved by beauty. Why should beautiful things have to be sacrificed? And in fact, if you talk to people, they don't want that. There's a story that's told of the construction of the Cathedral of St. John the Divine in the Upper West Side of Manhattan. It's an Episcopalian cathedral. It was begun at the end of the 19th century, ground to a halt during the Great Depression. It's still technically not finished. But when it was grinding to a halt in the 1920s and the 1930s, there were a number of people living on the streets of New York, then as today, sad to say, and they actually asked some of them, you know, do you think the Episcopalians should in fact continue to build this church? Couldn't they be giving the money to you so you can go back into your house or you can get some food or something? And several of the people who were interviewed, they said, well, why can we not appreciate beauty as well? Why should we who have lost so much be deprived of the splendors of beauty? You know? So there's more to feeding the human person than just food and shelter. The spirit needs to be fed as well. This is one of my favorites. For those of you who have read the works of Evelyn Waugh, the great mid-20th century English novelist, Catholic writer, his perhaps most celebrated work, Brideshead Revisited. It came out last year as a movie, a really quite horrible movie. I don't recommend seeing it. It was a kind of typical Hollywood reduction of a complex tale into sodomy and incest. See the early 1980s BBC version that was turned into a television miniseries over a very lavish 13 hours. It's a wonderful production. This is a screenshot of the actor there who plays Rex Mottram. Rex is actually a Canadian, a kind of a bumbling colonial, who comes across very well, is very well polished, is very successful, he makes a lot of money, he goes into politics. On the surface, looks very good, but right beneath the surface, you realize that he's incredibly ignorant and knows very little. Anyway, he wants to marry into a Catholic family, a very old Catholic family, the central family in the story, the Flights. And so he's going to take instruction to actually convert. And this is an excerpt of the dialogue between him and the priest. The priest is saying, well, I'm going to quiz him and see, you know, does he really understand things? Is he learning the catechism? Does he really have enough, you know, brain to be able to understand these things? And so he poses this very famous question, you know, who is the Pope and how do we understand papal infallibility? And papal infallibility is probably one of the issues that Catholics themselves are not always very clear on. And Mottram's answer is kind of a classic, a bit of humor in the middle of the novel there, in which the priest quizzes him, and we see the answer here. Well, you know, it would in fact rain, except we're just too sinful to see it. It'd be kind of spiritually raining. Infallibility is often misunderstood. It is easier to say what it is not. It does not mean the Pope is perfect. It does not mean he is of impeccable character. It does not mean he is the smartest person in the world. It does not mean he can predict really anything at all, the future, the weather, the World Series, the presidential election, none of that. It's what's technically called a negative charism, which simply means that in those very rare moments where the Pope feels called to clarify a point of doctrine, the Holy Spirit will simply not let him screw it up. It doesn't mean that it will be the best opportunity or the best time for the Pope to say something. It doesn't mean that that the Pope isn't going to make all kinds of other mistakes in other areas, but in those very rare, very precise moments where it comes down to a serious, serious point of fundamental doctrine, he's not going to be able to screw it up. In what he publishes, what he states, what he teaches, that document will be protected from error. That's all it means, nothing more than that. It's a very precise teaching. And it pertains not to the Pope as a person, but to the Pope as an office. It's not a personal charism, it's a charism of the office. You know, him as teacher of the faith. Not him as governor of Vatican City State, not him as in some of the other roles that he exercises that we'll look at, but simply as teacher of the faith, responsible for the faith of the universal church. That is simply what papal infallibility is. The misunderstandings of infallibility go hand in hand oftentimes with what I think, I hope we'll clarify tonight, is something of a faulty or an unbalanced ecclesiological vision that people sometimes have of the Pope and his authority in the church. You know, there's kind of God up there, sort of floating around, keeping an eye on the universe, and then he's got the Pope there, you know, at the head of the church, who's this kind of all-seeing, all-knowing sort of figure, who keeps watch on everything, who knows everything, who has all the power, and then there's kind of the rest of us down below, you know, priests, deacons, lay faithful, and, you know, the bishops. The bishops might be up a little higher than that, but what really matters here is the Pope, you know, and he's this kind of omnipotent, omniscient figure. That's a model of ecclesiology that I think some people still have today. I was doing some research a couple years ago reading the letters and the newspapers of some bishops in the province of Quebec when 50 years ago this year Pope John the 23rd announced the convocation of what would become the Second Vatican Council. And some of the bishops wrote in their diocesan papers at the time, what do we need a council for? We have the Pope. He can just tell us what to do and we'll do it. No, I mean, these are bishops. These are bishops themselves. So there has been, I think, a certain distorted understanding of ecclesiology in the church. It's changed a lot in 50 years, but there's still something of that there, I think. It's not been helped, I have to say, by certain developments in John Paul's papacy. And I don't want to be misunderstood here. I think it's impossible to think of John Paul as anything other than an extraordinary figure on the world stage. His accomplishments are myriad, and his pontificate is and was studded with superlatives. Did many, many extraordinary things, leaving the church and the world in much, much better shape. But there has been under him, and I don't want to suggest that he was doing this deliberately or certainly not doing it maliciously, but there was very much a focus on him as a person. This is not all the covers of time. This is all I could fit on this slide. There were more covers of time on which he featured. But this one here on the left, I think, is at least a little bit troubling. This great focus on him almost as a kind of a sacred celebrity. And that, I don't think, is entirely helpful in understanding the proper nature and running of the church. Now, I'm not saying John Paul did that on his own. He was not an egomaniac who was out seeking praise and glory. You know, I think he was very faithful to his patron saint, John the Baptist, you know, whose great mantra is that Christ must increase and I must decrease. I don't think John Paul saw himself as being out there for his own sake. He used the position and the attention and the celebrity always to point the way to Christ. But nonetheless, at the level of popular imagination, it seems to me that there were certain exaggerations in the nature of the church. This, I think, is a really quite brilliant picture taken last year in Washington when Pope Benedict came here. Because I think this captures for some people how they understand themselves vis-a-vis the Pope in the church today. He's bigger than we are, he can see us, and we're kind of down below. And it doesn't matter how many people are down there, you know, the kind of an undifferentiated mass. What matters is this guy up the top who is big, who is watching over us, who is telling us what to do, talking at us. that's the Pope, you know, at the level of popular imagination. This kind of all-knowing, all-seeing, very powerful sort of figure, whose office is just all-encompassing, you know, this kind of massive presence on the world stage today. That's somewhat troubling when you consider the actual nature of the church today, and it's even more troubling when you consider the challenges of Christian unity. That kind of distortion, that kind of overemphasis on the papal office doesn't serve the church well, and it certainly doesn't serve the cause of Christian unity well. It plays into some fairly old criticisms, if not stereotypes, of both Protestant and Orthodox Christians, who tend to be very leery of an institution that seems to bulk this large, that seems to have this amount of power. And so we get the criticism that the papacy has become something of a cult of a personality. And that's a phrase that is not mine. It's a phrase that's been used by a number of people, including Eamon Duffy, the great Cambridge historian of the papacy. If you want to read, and you only have time to read one volume of papal history, his Saints and Sinners, which came out in 1997 and then was reissued in 2006, is a really outstanding one volume. Duffy's a serious Catholic, and he's a very serious and very widely respected historian. He holds the two things in tension. And says, the papacy has done extraordinary things. There have been many outstandingly saintly figures, but there have been some rather roguish characters as well who have not always served the church the way they should have. And I think that's captured in this famous Lenten icon, the Ladder of Divine Ascent. You know, we have in the top right-hand corner Christ waiting to welcome the faithful who make it up to the ladder. And then here on the bottom, we have the demons trying to pull people down, and in some cases, successfully doing that. And that seems to me to capture the nature of the popes as human beings. Some lead many people, many faithful, to heaven by virtue of their leadership and their extraordinary holiness. Others lead them to other places by virtue of their failures. No pope is perfect. That's sometimes another stereotype, I think, or misunderstanding. They're all human beings, they're all sinners. We can't be romantic and gloss over those facts. Neither, however, can we be unduly critical and say, well, you know, they should all just be disbanded. This overemphasis on the papal office has come in for criticism that began in about 1968. And was led by none other than this young theologian you see here, whose visage you might recognize. And that, of course, is the theologian Joseph Ratzinger, whom today, of course, we know as Pope Benedict the 16th. And Benedict wrote a series of articles in the 1960s and the 1970s, looking critically at the papacy and what had become of it, particularly as it faced the challenge of Christian unity. And he said, you know, there are going to need to be some changes here, because the way the papacy has developed, especially in the second millennium, is simply not helpful. It has grown too large in some respects. It has taken on responsibilities that are not its own, properly speaking, and we need to pare those back and rearrange things a little bit. And so a very famous lecture, that first paragraph, that he gave in Graz in 1976, in which he talked about the necessity of understanding the papacy anew in light of the way it was lived in the first millennium, when the church was united. East and West were one church. And then again, in a book-length interview he gave in 2002 when he was working in Rome as the head of the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith, he spoke again of the fact that there was a kind of over-centralization within Rome of too many responsibilities that the Pope had, and that needs to be kind of divided up. That there are things that have accrued to the Pope and to the Pope's helpers, the Roman Curia, that they do not necessarily need to do. And therefore, we need to see some kind of devolution, some decentralization within the papacy. That is very much a desideratum that has not yet been fully realized, although I think Benedict is putting some of those pieces into play now that he occupies the very office for which he was pressing for changes. This overemphasis on the Pope and the papal office as this kind of almost superhuman figure conflicts very sharply with one of the greatest holders of the office, namely Pope St. Gregory I, Pope Gregory the Great, as he's otherwise known, and this very famous passage in which he describes himself as the servus servorum Dei, the servant of the servants of God. He does not want to be exalted. He does not want to be seen as this kind of omnipotent figure. He does not want to be glorified. He wants to be seen as someone who is a bishop among his brother bishops, and when one is honored, they are all honored. That's still a title that the popes hold to this day, and I think in many respects that's far and away the most important one that they have. Okay, having looked at some of those misconceptions, not all of them, but a few of them, what I want to do now is kind of look at some of the terms and some of the actual offices that we're talking about. You know, with Pope, Papacy, Vatican, Holy See, all this language that's out there that oftentimes kind of gets, lumped in together. What are we talking about here? What are some of these offices, some of these institutions? They're not entirely interchangeable. There are some differences between them that I want us to take a look at. But generally speaking, when we use any one of those terms, people are referring to, in broad terms, the central organ of government in the Catholic Church. But as I say, there are some differences between those. Those particular offices. Thank you. So we break it down. The Pope is the person. That's perhaps the simplest one, who occupies or exercises the office known as the papacy. That office is based in, exercised from, the Pope lives in, something called the Vatican, or the Vatican City-State, more properly. And then we have the Holy See. The Holy See is kind of the most abstract of those. You can't really touch the Holy See, per se. But the Holy See is both the state recognized in international law, and also the term used to define the sovereignty of the Church. If you wanted to translate this chart into kind of American political categories, you would say, Pope is the equivalent of the president, the papacy is the equivalent of the presidency, the Vatican is the equivalent of the White House, and the Holy See is, the equivalent of the U.S. administration as such, or the, the federal government kind of thing as such. Those are, I think, fairly accurate kind of analogies. But as you can see, there are some differences here. They're not exactly interchangeable institutions. Start with the Holy See, perhaps, as I say, the most abstract one, the one the most difficult to imagine or conceive of. The Holy See is a term that describes the particular authority, sovereignty, jurisdiction that is exercised at the center of the Church. Its etymological roots pertain to a seat, literally, a seat or a chair from which the occupant exercises the particular office that he holds over a particular area and from which he exercises his office as teacher, as governor, and as sanctifier. And so the seat from which the Pope rules as head of the Holy See is pictured here in the traditional apsidal location in the Archbasilica of St. John Lateran in Rome. And we see Pope Benedict there shortly after his election, taking possession of his seat and saying, I'm here now, I've been elected to this office, I'm going to sit in my chair that nobody else can sit in. So it's a very practical thing. Because the Church is very practical. The Church is always incarnational and takes these things seriously. This is the same for all other bishops around the world. The Pope is the Bishop of Rome, as we'll talk about in a moment, who has a see and a seat, and all other bishops right around the world have the same setup. Bishop Darcy, the Roman Catholic bishop of this geographical territory, known as the Diocese of Fort Wayne, South Bend, that's him on the right here, holding his crozier, has his seat in the Cathedral of the Immaculate Conception, which is just downtown, from which he exercises his office as teacher, as sanctifier, as governor over this particular geographical territory of northern Indiana. He does that just like every other bishop in the world, including the Bishop of Rome. Well, what exactly is the territory of the Holy See? That's a question we'll have to come back to a little bit. At first blush, it's universal, but in fact, there's a lot more to it than that. And it's exercised very differently in different parts of the world. And it's by no means a clear question today whether that territory will continue as it has been, or whether there are changes afoot. I think there are, in view of the events with the Anglicans this week. We'll come back to that. So the Holy See describes, you know, the most abstract part of the church's central administration. The Holy See is the institution with which other governments in the world have international relations. Pope Benedict here is receiving the letters of credence, or the credential letters, from Marianne Glendon, who was the ambassador of the United States to the Holy See, appointed by President Bush during the last year and a bit of his administration. And so she is basically going to the Pope and saying, well, you know, President Bush has sent me here as his ambassador. I'm coming to present my official credentials to you and make myself known to you. And the Pope is dressed as a head of state here. He's wearing the ermine mazzetta, the red kind of half cape, and then the stole of state around his neck. He's dressed as head of state there. That red that you see is the official color of the papacy. That's why, for example, the color of the vestments at Pope John Paul's funeral were all red, because that's the official color, which ties back to the official colors of the Roman emperors. The Pope is one of many figures who have responsibility within the Holy See. He is aided by a series of people known as the Roman Curia. These are various people who work in Rome, occupying various offices, from the very lowly people who clean the carpets to the cardinals, who are the Pope's closest collaborators, who help. You know, it's a very demanding position, as you can imagine, looking out for more than a billion people, and so he needs some assistance, and the Roman Curia is there to provide that. That's a little bit about the Holy See. In more concrete terms now, let's look a little bit at the Vatican. What is the Vatican? Well, the Vatican designates a very ancient part of the city of Rome on the right, the Vatican Hill, on the right bank of the Tiber. If you're standing from the north looking down, you'll see the Vatican on the right bank of the Tiber River here. Caligula's circus was there. St. Peter was thought to have been martyred thereabouts. There has been significance attached to this part of the city of Rome for a long time. Down through the centuries, a church would be built and further buildings would be built around there that would today give us the buildings and the territory held by the Vatican City State. How did we get that? Well, we need to go back a little bit in history. This is a very different concept that from what most of us would be used to, especially in an American context today, where we have a very pronounced notion of the separation of church and state. That's not a notion that is shared by most of Christian history until very recently. And so we have church and state more or less married for a good deal of Christian history, both in the West and in the East. And we see that in the territory that gradually is accrued to the Pope. And we have the Papal States occupying a very large part of the central Italian peninsula, from which the Pope actually ruled, not just as head of the church, but head of a state, with an army and a navy and a police force and jails and taxes and all of the accoutrements that we associate with the head of a state. The exact territory is going to vary a little bit down through the ages, but by the end of the 18th century, this is more or less what is intact, and will remain so for about another 75 years, 1869-1870 is when the papal states are finally lost in the process of reunification of Italy, or of the creation of the modern Italian nation-state. At that point, the popes lose their role as head of a particular state. And from then until 1929, they were kind of stateless. Pope Pius IX, under whom the territories were first lost, and his successors, Leo XIII, Pius X, Benedict XV, and Pius XI, all felt themselves to be in a very awkward, unusual, difficult situation. We no longer are in charge of our destiny, as it were. We no longer have state. We're kind of living at the pleasure of the Italian government. And that was a very disconcerting position for the church to be in. So Pope Pius XI entered into an agreement with the head of the Italian government, Benito Mussolini, at the time, to establish what we today know as the Vatican City-State. This was established under the Lateran Treaty, by which certain buildings and certain territories within the city of Rome were ceded to the church and recognized as the church's sovereign territory. Not Italian soil, but Vatican soil. And that has remained ever since down to this day. And so the Vatican city-state then is this piece within the city of Rome that in the central feature of which, of course, is the Basilica of St. Peter's that is such a familiar landmark to so many, but includes some of the other buildings within the old Leonine Wall, a few other extraterritorial buildings within Rome, and then it includes Castel Gandolfo, which is some miles north of Rome in the Alban Hills, and it's the papal summer residence. For those of you that have been to Rome in July and August, you'll know that it's just beastly hot and humid, and all of the Romans get out of town if they possibly can, because of course many ancient buildings do not have modern air conditioning. And the Pope leaves town as well to go to some place where the temperature is a little more tolerable in this residence that he was given for his summer use. So Castel Gandolfo, together with the buildings and the land here, within the city of the Vatican, constitute internationally recognized sovereign territory that belong to the church, and the church has exclusive jurisdiction over that land and those buildings and the activities that go on within them. Looked a little bit at Holy See, a little bit of the Vatican, now at the figure of the Pope himself. The term Pope is quite ordinary. It's not a unique term. It's from the Greek into the Latin, and it simply means father. And in the early church, that was a title that many people with authority actually had. The Pope of Rome was not alone in having that particular title. There is, in fact, There is, in fact, another pope who's out there who has the title, who's had the title longer than the Pope of Rome, and that is His Holiness Shenouda III, who is the Pope of Alexandria and the Patriarch of the See of St. Mark. He's the head of the Coptic Orthodox Church today. And in fact, he's been called Pope longer than the Pope of Rome has been. So that title is not in itself especially unique. The Pope is called many other things as well. He has quite a list here of titles. We'll break them down just a little bit to see what they describe and what some of the differences are among them. His most important, his most basic title is the Bishop of Rome. If he's not the Bishop of Rome, he's not the Pope. And if he's not a bishop, he can't be the Pope until he is, in fact, ordained a bishop. Some of the other titles that he has that we see listed here. If we take a look at them, we see that this looks like a very impressive list, but it in fact describes some very different realities. If you want to put it in the form of a colloquialism, you'd say the Pope wears many hats. Some of them more kind of whimsical, as we see down here greeting some Austrian tourists. Some of them fly off in the wind in the piazza. Some of them he wears liturgically, as with the mitre on the upper left, and others he wears when he's outside, either in the summer or the winter, a very practical hat, not a hat with any real liturgical significance. So the titles. The most important ones are really on the left. And as I say, the Bishop of Rome is his most ancient title, because the Pope is nothing but a bishop. He has additional responsibilities, but he is a bishop first and foremost, just as all other bishops are in the church. And that's a point of real importance. There is no special service that conveys any special grace to the Pope when he is elected Pope. It's his ordination as a bishop that is the most important. The election of Pope brings some additional responsibilities. It doesn't bring any additional sacramental grace. From the title of Bishop of Rome, he has additional responsibilities for the surrounding territories within his province, and hence he has the title of the Archbishop and Metropolitan of the Roman province. The other significant title that actually has authority is Supreme Pontiff of the Universal Church. These other titles that we see here are of a different nature. The sovereign of the Vatican City State is not really an ecclesiastical title, it's a secular kind of political title. And these other titles that we see here are more kind of honorifics. They don't actually carry authority with them per se. They describe his office more fulsomely, but they don't actually give him any more kind of clout or responsibility in a kind of a tangible sense. So said, his title, his office as the Bishop of Rome is far and away the most important, without which nothing else really matters. When we think of his title as the Bishop of Rome, this is the title, or this is the picture that often comes to mind. People think of the great Basilica of St. Peter, the Vatican Basilica, and the piazza there with the famous colonnades that seems to kind of stretch out and welcome the whole world. But that's not the most important church for him as the Bishop of Rome. This is the Arch Basilica of St. John Lateran. This is the church where we saw Benedict seated a few minutes ago in his seat, his cathedra, from which he exercises his office as the Bishop of Rome. So this is, in fact, the most important church for him. There we see him again seated in the Lateran Basilica. Why the Bishop of Rome? Why is Rome so front and central within Catholic history, within papal history? What is the significance of the city of Rome itself? Well, if you ask many Catholics today, including, I think, many people who work in Rome, they would tell you that number three up there, the Apostolic Foundation, is really the most important reason. But that's not the case. That's a very modern interpretation. The city of Rome is the central city for the Catholic Church because it was the capital of the Roman Empire. That's it. If it had not been the capital at the time of the formation of the Christian Church, Rome would not have been anything at all. This is what the Czech Jesuit historian Francis Dvornik famously called the principle of accommodation. The early Christians, prior to the Edict of Toleration in 313, did not have time or the luxury of establishing jurisdictions and territories and setting up institutions because they were too busy trying to avoid being killed. They simply accommodated themselves to the existing institutional arrangements of the Roman Empire. And we see this very clearly in the canons of several of the ecumenical councils. The very first ecumenical council of Nicaea in 325 already refers to this well-established practice of deferring to the Bishop of Rome because he is the bishop of the imperial capital. The first council of Constantinople, that is the second ecumenical council in 381, in its third canon, very laconic, very direct, says, because it is the new Rome, the Bishop of Constantinople is to enjoy the privileges of honor after the Bishop of Rome. And then the Council of Chalcedon in 451 gets even more to the point, and they say that the fathers rightly accorded prerogatives to the see of older Rome, since that is an imperial city. That's the rationale. That's the reason why Rome is so important. Today, and for many centuries before today, many Catholics have been inclined to say, well, the city of Rome is important because, well, that's where Peter was. That's not how the early Christians understood it, and that was not a significant factor for them. It was the imperial capital. Therefore, it's the most important city, and the bishop of that city is going to be the most important bishop. It's a very simple, very practical arrangement that the early church had. After that, Rome is given additional recognition because of the orthodoxy of its faith. The famous letter of Ignatius of Antioch and the famous letter of Irenaeus of Lyon, both praising the Pope and the Church and the Christians in Rome because they hold fast to the faith they have received. It's not because the Christians in Rome or the bishop in Rome had some kind of special authority. He did not. The third, and it is very much third reason, has to do with the apostolic foundation of the see of the Church of Rome. The place where both Paul and Peter would spend some of the last years of their life witnessing and would in fact lose their lives in witness to Christ there. That is probably the only reason most Catholics today think of the importance of the city of Rome. But for centuries in the early church, that would have been so commonplace as to be almost nonsensical, or at the very least, unremarkable. All of the other major centers within the Christian church had apostolic foundation. So for Rome to say, well, it was because of Peter and Paul, the other centers of Antioch, of Constantinople, of Alexandria, and especially of Jerusalem, would have just shrugged and said, yeah, so do we. So the notion that the apostolic foundation is key is one that's quite sharply at odds with Christian history. What happens to make the apostolic foundation such a significant argument in the favor of the primacy of Rome? To answer that question, we need to know a little bit of the history. May of 330, the Emperor Constantine decides he's getting out of Rome. He's become a Christian, he's converted, and Rome, of course, the so-called Eternal City, has for centuries a very pagan past, a very pagan history. And Constantine says, I don't want to be reminded of that. He's a bit like the alcoholic who can't go back to the neighborhood tavern or bar with his buddies anymore because it just awakens certain passions that he's struggling against. Constantine goes and builds a brand new capital on the Bosphorus, names it rather immodestly after himself, and transfers everything there and inaugurates the city of Constantinople in May of 330. Now that is the capital. And it's not just Constantinople, but it's also known as New Rome. Well, you can imagine what that does to a city, not to be too Freudian about it, but you can imagine kind of the self-esteem of a city depleting fairly rapidly once something like that has happened. And that's in fact exactly what happens to Rome. By the time of the transfer of the capital in 330, there are approximately 1 million people living in the city of Rome. By the year 400, we're down to 800,000. By the year 500, we're down to 100,000. And after the finish of the sack of Rome in 546, it bottoms out at 30,000 people. The person who is exercising leadership in the vacuum that's opened up now with the transfer of the capital and the loss of the presence of the emperor is going to be the Bishop of Rome. And in this case, it's Pope Leo the Great, who really begins to build up the city of Rome again after the devastating loss of its imperial status. Pope Leo is Pope from 440 to 461, so he's in the aftermath of the loss of the status. And if you read his correspondence, and there's a new book published by Susan Wessel of Catholic University of America that does a very good job at bringing this to the fore. You see Leo struggling with this issue on behalf of his people. What do we do now? We've lost our focus. We've lost our clout. What do we do now? We're no longer the imperial capital. What significance could we possibly have within the church? And it's at that point that Leo really begins this identification of the Pope with the person of Peter. And the argument from apostolicity acquires great, great significance in the early church at this point. And in fact, the argument from apostolicity will become so influential that other Christians in other parts of the empire start cottoning onto it and saying, oh, well, who's our apostle exactly? You know, everybody seems to think you have to have an apostle today to be really authentic. Who's ours? And so you see New Rome, which again is the capital, simply, which is it was, is a significant Christian center simply because it's become the capital. Constantinople starts casting about saying, well, who's our apostle? Where do we get our apostolicity from? You know, Leo's over in Rome banging on about the fact that Peter and Paul have been there, and that's really the central argument. Well, what do we have to say to Leo? And so you see the argument start to take root in Constantinople. And they start generating this theory that the Apostle Andrew was in Constantinople. Well, the evidence for that is pretty much non-existent. But it's important. It answers a felt need. We've got to have an apostle here, because Leo says, well, you can't really be a center of authority in the church if you don't have an apostle behind you. So we've got to have an apostle. So Constantinople starts casting about for an apostle, and they fasten on to Andrew. Why Andrew? Well, yeah, you've got Peter, and you know Peter was fairly important in the Gospels. Yeah, that's fine. But we've got Andrew. And who's Andrew? He's the first called. So you can have Peter. That's fine. We got the guy who was first, you know? And so they start generating these notions of apostolicity that get really carried away, especially later towards the end of the first millennium with the conversion of the Slavs. And then you start hearing this idea that, well, Andrew didn't just go to Constantinople. He actually went all the way far as Kievan Rus to the capital, of modern-day Ukraine, made it up there because of this argument of apostolicity. But that kind of distorts the history in some significant ways. What are they accommodating themselves to? Well, again, this is all imperial political divisions and decisions that the early Christians are going to go along with. Already under Diocletian, there's a basic practical division of the empire. It's too big, it's too large, it's too complicated for one man to run. He's going to divide it into East and West. And so when we talk about Eastern and Western Christianity, these are not religious terms per se. There's no theological content to those geographical labels. We're simply talking about the fact that Christians found themselves on one side or the other of the division of the empire that was taken without any input from Christians. Christians just went along with it. They accommodated themselves to it. So if you ended up on the eastern side of Diocletian's division, you retained the use of Greek as a cultural and liturgical language, and you looked to Constantinople for your leadership, and you based yourself on the liturgical tradition of Constantinople. If you were on the other side, Rome was your center, Latin was your language, and you followed the West Roman liturgical tradition. So all of the language that Christians to this day use, Lutherans, Episcopalians, Catholics, and Orthodox, to describe their church structures is imperial language. It's not religious language, it's not theological language. Diocese, metropolitanate, province, exarch, eparchy, this is all imperial language that comes from initially from Diocletian, and then it's confirmed by Constantine, and it will be retained by Justinian. So they're accommodating themselves to the imperial structures of the Roman Empire, and they're also accommodating themselves to the urban centers of the Roman Empire. Again, for very practical reasons. You've just discovered, the cure for cancer. You don't want to keep that to yourself. You want to spread that out, and you want to let people know, because that's a pretty fantastic thing that you've just discovered. Well, if you're living in a day and age when we don't have, Twitter and Facebook and faxes and emails and phone calls and cell phones and all the modern means of communication, how are you going to get your message out? You're going to go where the people are. And that's exactly what the Christians felt and did. We have this fantastic message, you can survive death. Christianity, if you want to boil it down to a sentence, is a way to survive death. Christ has conquered death. Doesn't that sound like good news? Well, let's go out and tell people. Okay, well, where are the people? Well, they're in the big cities. So we're going to go to the big cities. And so the Christians accommodated themselves to these urban realities as well. Rome, because it was the imperial capital. Constantinople, because it becomes the imperial capital, New Rome. And then some of these other major centers. Antioch is the gateway to the Far East. It was a major center within the early church. Alexandria, a very ancient city, predates Christianity. Also very important for the governance of the Church of North Africa. And then almost as an afterthought, Christians throw into the mix Jerusalem. Jerusalem was never a politically important city. But they say, well, you know, we can't really ignore Jerusalem because, you know, Antioch had Peter. Antioch's a Petrine see before Rome is. Rome had Peter and Paul. Constantinople, well, maybe they had Andrew. Alexandria had Mark. But Jerusalem had them all. So we can't overlook Jerusalem. So these are the five centers of authority, the five patriarchal centers of leadership within the early church that Christians accommodated themselves to. So that's a little bit about why Rome and how Rome acquired the status. Now I think we need to look at the question, well, why have a pope? Whether he's in Rome or whether he's in Fort Wayne or whether he's on the moon somewhere, why have a pope at all? What's the purpose of this guy? What's his job? You can sum that up in one word. The pope, as we saw earlier, wears many hats and has many titles, but his central responsibility is the unity of the church. And so we see him in the top left there with the Anglican Archbishop of Canterbury, and we see him in November of 2006 in Constantinople with Patriarch Bartholomew, the Orthodox Patriarch of Constantinople. And we read in Lumen Gentium 23, the document of the Second Vatican Council, this very clear statement of the Pope's responsibilities. He is to keep the church united. That's his main job. That's why Catholics believe that the Pope is necessary to the function of the church, to keep everybody together. Now, the popes have not always done such a hot job at that. And the two popes prior to the current one, two of the three prior to the current one, have just flat out acknowledged that. 1967, Paul VI just says, you know that I am the real problem. My office is the big stumbling block to unity with Protestant Christians in the West and Eastern Christians as well. John Paul II would go one better and not only repeat the recognition, but apologize and ask for forgiveness, and then do something even more extraordinary than that. And say, I know that popes have been responsible, have been a stumbling block, have given scandal, have played their own role in the division of Christians, and I'm sorry for that. Then he goes on to say in his 1995 letter on Christian unity, help me. You know, in paragraph 95, this unprecedented plea that he puts out there, could not church leaders, that is, non-Catholics especially, help me in a fraternal dialogue discover a way that my office would no longer be a stumbling block, but would be something that we could all agree on? Extraordinary, absolutely extraordinary for a pope to do that. And there have been a number of responses, and that's a process that's ongoing. How good has the Pope been as a uniter? Well, I mean, if you look at 1.1 billion Catholics today, that's an impressive number to kind of keep all in one house. But there have been a number of divisions in Christian history. I do not mean to suggest that these are by any means exclusively the responsibility of the Pope, but these are the main divisions that have arisen within the church, and these are the challenges that the popes face today to try and overcome. The very first one is more ancient than most people realize. The first split among Christians goes all the way back to the Council of Chalcedon. We're very close to healing that. The official dialogues with the non-Chalcedonian Orthodox Christians have realized that when it comes to the question of Christology, we really are on the same page. We're just using somewhat different language. So it's very close to healing that first and most ancient of schisms. The split of 1054, as it's conventionally dated. The church didn't exactly fall apart in 1054. It's not really until the Fourth Crusade and the sack of Constantinople in 1204 that things are really rendered apart. But 1054 is the date you read in all the history books. The split of East and West. We've come a long way to healing that. There was another big meeting on this topic just last week in Cyprus. There's a ways to go, but we're moving towards it. Please God, we'll finally come to heal that split between the East and the West. Of course, the various splits that took place in Germany and Switzerland and England and elsewhere during the 16th century, a few smaller divisions since then that have come about. I mention these again, not because this is the exclusive fault or responsibility of the Pope, but because the Pope feels these splits perhaps more acutely than other Christian leaders do, because he knows that when he stands before the awesome tribunal of Christ, the question that's going to be asked of him is, how well did you keep my church together? And so the popes cannot avoid the question of Christian division. And the current pope and his predecessor have felt those divisions very acutely and felt themselves very compelled towards trying to heal them. What are they trying to heal? What is that process going to look like? It's not going to consist of everybody just kind of agreeing to disagree and we'll all sit down and hold hands smoke a peace pipe and sing some songs around the campfire. And you can continue to believe what you believe and I'll continue to believe what I believe and ne'er the twain shall meet. The unity of Christians can only be a unity in the truth. And if it's not a unity in the truth, then it's going to fall apart and it's not worth having in the first place. That makes the search for unity all the more difficult, but in the end, when we secure that kind of unity, that's the kind that's going to last. So it's not just about getting along or being nice. It's about finding unity in the truth. And the truth for Christians is not a what. As a professor of mine used to always say, it's a who. It's a person. It's Jesus Christ. And if we're united in him, and the closer we draw to him, the more we will draw towards one another. So it needs to be unity in the truth. And we need to hammer out these difficult issues on which we continue to disagree. Questions of faith or doctrine, questions of morals or practice. That is the responsibility of the Pope, to really hammer home those questions and not let us duck out from those particular questions. That sometimes rubs people the wrong way. You know, who is this guy to be really saying what we need to do and what we can do and what we can't do? The Southern physician and writer and Catholic novelist Walker Percy, this line that's attributed to him, that without Rome, what you have is California. In other words, you have this kind of free-for-all. You know, hey, whatever floats your boat, man, you know? The popes aren't allowed to go along with that because they know that that's not what God wants. And they know that that's never going to really unite people. It needs to be unity in the truth, and we need to hammer home those difficult issues that we continue to disagree on. We can't duck them out and try and you know, as one senator said during the Vietnam War, let's just declare victory and call the boys home. That's not the way forward for the church. So the bishops, together with the Bishop of Rome, have a responsibility for teaching and preaching the truth, who is Jesus Christ. So we see local Bishop John Darcy here in a class at Notre Dame a couple of years ago with a graduate, Bridget Becker, of our own Department of Theology here, and then the Pope last April in Washington at Catholic University of America. Their responsibility is to teach the truth. Whether it's popular or not, that is their responsibility, and the thing that is asked of the church, asked of Catholics, is to receive that, to listen to it and to follow it, knowing that in listening to them on these fundamental questions, one is listening to the apostles who were appointed by God. He who hears you hears me, as Christ says to his first disciples. Again, this is not a popular notion. We touched on this a little bit earlier with that editorialist's cartoon about the mindless thinking of Catholics who kind of empty their brains and do whatever the Pope says. And this very famous 20th century Jesuit theologian, Henri Cardinal de Lubac, has this wonderful reflection on the nature of Catholic authority and the nature of Catholic obedience. It's an apprenticeship. It's a learning process. It's a humbling of yourself so that you can hear and follow the voice of Christ. You are not important. You know, the one of the most irritating lines you hear, especially as a parent, oh, why are we going to church? It's not very fun. What do I get out of it? It's not what you get out of it. You're not important. What you go to church for is to give God glory. What you listen to the church for is to give God glory and to hear what God wants to say. Now, this is often misunderstood. It's not a kind of mindless thing. You know, Catholic obedience doesn't mean that the Pope is going to tell you tomorrow to go out and buy as a Bavarian, you're going to go out and buy a BMW, or eat a certain kind of tuna fish, or brush your teeth in a certain way. None of these things. Simply on the most important questions, he says, follow me because I'm following Christ. He doesn't say follow me because I like this position, or this is my own enlightened idea, or I'm really smart and you're not, therefore do what I tell you. He says, follow me in the truth because I'm proclaiming what Christ would have me proclaim. If it were only his position, only his opinion, he should be ignored with impunity. But because he has this office, because all bishops have this office, and when exercised properly, they should in fact be listened to because they're not speaking on their own behalf, they're speaking on behalf of Christ. Some of the recent developments in the search for unity that give us, I think, some hope. A number of developments and agreements in the international Lutheran Catholic dialogue, a number in the international Anglican Catholic dialogue, the Catholic Orthodox International Commission, all have sought to try and answer this request of Pope John Paul from 1995. What do I need to do? How does my office need to be reconfigured so that it will no longer be an obstacle to unity, but an instrument of unity? So we see the Pope Benedict in the top here greeting, sharing the kiss of peace with the Patriarch Bartholomew. And then the start of the Jubilee year of 2000, John Paul II, flanked by a Greek Orthodox bishop on the right here, and then the then Archbishop of Canterbury, George Carey, on his left. Just some concluding comments on the nature of the church. We've looked at these institutions and these figures. We've only touched on them. There's so much history in the papacy that we could, we could gather again for one of these lectures every week from now until, Christ returns in glory, and we wouldn't be able to exhaust it. So I do encourage you, if this is a particular interest of yours, there are lots of books out there, and we can talk about those afterwards if you're interested in more of the history of the papacy. I want to conclude with a few comments on the nature of the church as such, so that we don't get too caught up in the personalities and the intrigue and the politics and so on of papal history. It's been often said that one of the besetting problems of Western Christianity is a kind of crypto-Arianism, and one of the problems besetting Eastern Christianity is a kind of a crypto-monophysitism. What do we mean by that? Well, Arianism, of course, is summed up most simply is basically a denial of the divinity of Christ, and monophysitism is basically a denial of the humanity of Christ. So they're kind of mirror images of each other in some ways. Officially condemned at the first, second, fourth, fifth, and sixth ecumenical councils, nonetheless still have some staying power in the world today. We've been doing something, I think, that inclines towards a kind of crypto-Arianism in focusing too much on the human side of the church. I want to conclude by focusing a little bit on the divine side of the church. We've asked the question, why have a pope? What does the pope do? What's his job? I want to finish by asking the question, well, why have a church at all? Why just not turn it into a kind of a free-for-all? You don't have to get out of bed on Sunday morning. You can just kind of sit in your room and privately think some nice thoughts and commune with God that way. Why even bother having a church? It's a very beautiful passage in a very ancient text that dates from somewhere around the year 150. The shepherd, by a figure known to us as Hermas, we don't know a whole lot about him, but we do know that this text of his was held in very high regard in the early church, so much so that some of the fathers thought it should actually be in the canon of Scripture. We have this vision here that is described in his text of an old woman. And so we read here, well, who do you think that is? And why is she old? And the answer is, this image, this dream that I've had, is of the church. And she's portrayed as an old woman because she's existed from the foundations of the world. And she has existed for the salvation of the world. For her sake was the world made. What is this church that Hermas and others are talking about? What is the purpose of this church vis-a-vis the world? The church is the body called out as a unique community within the world, God calls together to be his witness, to be his community, to be his family, to be, in fact, his own body. And that's a very important point that no less than Joseph Ratzinger himself has underscored many times over the years. The church is not our own. The church is not a plaything. The church is not a private club. The church is not something that I can do with whatever I want. And he's issued that reminder repeatedly to other theologians and to bishops. The reason why, to go back to one of the questions we started with, the Pope can't just unilaterally declare abortion a sacrament or contraception a great good or homosexuality something that gives God glory, is because he doesn't have that power. The church is not his. The Pope has a lot of authority within the church, but there are certain things he cannot change. He is as much a servant of the truth, as much a servant of Christian tradition and revelation as anybody else is. And so the church is not his to play with. The church is not his to rearrange. The church is not his to reconfigure according to whim or cultural dictates or some passing fad. He has to be faithful to what has been revealed as being part of God's plan, because the church is not his. It's not yours. It's not mine. The church is Christ's. And so what I think is one of the most felicitous passages in the Universal Catechism of 1992 helps us to understand a little more the precise nature of the church. The church is a sacrament. Of course, the most basic definition of sacrament is an outward and visible sign of an inward and spiritual grace. And the church is the outward sign and presence of God's gift of salvation in the person of Jesus Christ. So the church exists to bring people into contact with God, to lead them to God, and so to lead them to salvation. That's the purpose of the church. All the other things are incidental. The church exists first and foremost to bring people into contact with God. And the church does that preeminently in the sacraments. One of the great rediscoveries of the 20th century from the Second Vatican Council onward was of the Eucharistic nature of the church. The church doesn't exist on her own power. The church doesn't just continually create and recreate herself. The church exists from the side of Christ. The church exists from the Eucharist. And without the Eucharist, the church as such simply cannot exist as Christ's body in the world. And so the Eucharist makes the church, we say. A very ancient, very patristic notion, common in the East and rediscovered in the West after the Council. And so Christians are continually being grafted into the church and reformed in the church through the Eucharist and through the sacrament of confession in particular, among the others. Some of the other things we need to keep in mind about the church. This is one of the very famous styles of Marian iconography that we find in the Byzantine and Coptic traditions, known as the Hodegitria icon, which in Greek simply means she who points the way. And so the Mother of God here, the Most Holy Theotokos, is pointing to Christ. This is harkens back to the story of the transformation of water into wine and the wedding at Cana, when she tells the stewards, do whatever he tells you. Don't pay attention to me, I can't do anything. Go and pay attention to him. And that is also part of the nature of the church. The church points the way to Christ. The church leads us to Christ, doesn't point to herself. The four marks of the church, very common in certainly in the Creed, and certainly those of you that know the various catechisms, the unity of the church, first and foremost, reflecting the unity of God, who is one, while existing in three hypostases, or in three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, in the famous icon of Rublev, the Old Testament Trinity. And the Pope's job is to help keep the church one. That's his, as we saw earlier, his most important task. The second mark of the church that the Pope and the bishops and all of us have responsibility for is the holiness of the church. You know, every liturgical service of the Byzantine tradition has the great prayer, the great Trisagion prayer there. It reflects the prayer we believe the six-winged and many-eyed seraphim and cherubim sing around the throne of God. Agios o Theos, holy God. Agios Ischiros, holy and mighty. Agios athanatos, holy immortal one. Eleison emas, have mercy on us. The church is holy not because of anything we do. There was a controversy in 1999-2000 when Pope John Paul was preparing for the millennium and was going to apologize for certain things that Catholics had done to other people in the world. And some theologians within the church said, well, how can you do that? And so it was a moment of clarifying the point that the church is without sin, the church is holy, not because of anything we do, but because it is the body of Christ. So the analogy I often use with students here is to say the church is, to use an old patristic image, the church is the hospital. The church is the hospital for sinners. You don't say the hospital is sick. The hospital is full of sick people, but the hospital as such is not sick. And it's the same for the church. Catholic, in the original sense of the term, the wholeness of the church, what is whole, what is universal, what includes everybody. That is also part of the Pope's job, to make sure there's room at the table for everybody, whatever your nationality, whatever your background, to try and accommodate everybody. And what we saw 2 days ago this week is precisely an attempt to do that. In the new apostolic constitution that's being prepared in Rome for Anglicans and Episcopalians who wish to enter en masse into communion with the Catholic Church, there is a provision being made for them to be able to do that in a way that they have not been able to do so far. This has been, again, distorted somewhat in the media the last couple of days, you know, the Pope fishing in Anglican lakes or stealing Anglican sheeps, as it's been described. No, he's responding to a request that was made of him for people who want to enter into Catholic unity while retaining something of their own valid liturgical and spiritual patrimony. And so he's gone ahead and done something really unprecedented in the history of Catholic ecclesial structures and practices in creating these new ordinariates, not the nicest term, I suppose, to be able to accommodate people, because he knows that there has to be room at the table for everybody who wants to enter into the church, because it's not the Pope's church, it's not my church, it's God's church, and God wants everybody at the table. And we need to find some practical ways to accommodate these people, and that's precisely what they've been trying to do with the events of the past few days. And finally, of course, the church is apostolic, founded on the apostles, of whom for the Church of Rome, Peter and Paul are, of course, preeminent, the great princes. That is simply the way of saying we don't make things up in every generation. We don't recreate the faith. We are faithful to the faith once delivered, once received, the faith that has been believed by all the Christians down through the ages. How arrogant it would be of me to think that I somehow have a better idea about God, about the truth, about salvation, than all of these other people, all of these millions and millions and millions of people who have lived before me. I'm just going to suddenly recreate things. The church says, no, that's not how we work. We're faithful to what we've been given. And so, to sum everything up then, the Pope, as Bishop of Rome, is the holder of the papal office, from which he exercises from Vatican City State as the geopolitical manifestation of the authority, the sovereignty, the jurisdiction of the Holy See. His great job, his great challenge, is to make sure that the church is united, that the church remains faithful to who God is and what God asks of Christians, the unity in Christ. So again, the job of the Pope is to make sure that spot at the table there is never blocked, is always free so that people can enter into communion with God. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit seated around the table welcome people. Every person is to be welcomed. And the job of the church, the job of the Pope in particular, is to make sure that that welcome is extended and that nobody's access to God is blocked who genuinely seeks salvation. Questions and comments. Thanks.
How do you think the Anglican Episcopal recent events, what will that do for the Orthodox Catholic attempt at reunion?
I've just started to try and think through that very question myself, since that's, you know, kind of my area of particular interest. It's too early to tell, but I'm actually very hopeful. Because this new structure, as it's envisaged, is going to be a non-geographical structure, which is fairly unique. You know, we have these very ancient canons about one bishop to one city and canonical territory and these kind of notions. We kind of carve up the world and you stay over here and we'll be responsible over here. That doesn't work in the world today we live in, you know. I mean, there are more Eastern Christians living in the West than there are in, you know, Lebanon and Syria and Russia and so on. So geography is not the answer anymore. These non-geographical kind of personal structures that are being put together, I think, are quite significant and quite a hopeful sign that we can find ways around some of these big stumbling blocks. And it seems to me that what Benedict is doing is precisely what Paul VI described in, I think it was 1972, in talking to the Anglicans at that point. Paul said, "I long for the day when our sister church, the Anglicans, will be united but not absorbed within the Roman church." And it seems to me this structure that Benedict has envisaged is trying to do just that, to say we're not just going to kind of absorb you and you're all going to kind of come in and start looking and talking and praying and worshiping exactly as Roman Catholics do. We'll find a way of bringing you in, and you know, some of the beauty of your own tradition can remain. I think this is a good sign. I think this is a hopeful way to proceed and to show to the Orthodox churches precisely that it is possible to be united and not absorbed. It is possible to be united and not dominated. You know, the real problem for the East on the papacy, to use an old line, it's not the Pope we fear, it's the Pope's helpers. And we don't want to come in and be micromanaged by the Roman Curia. We elect our own bishops. We don't want somebody, however well-intentioned, however competent they are, appointing our bishops through a congregation and a secretive process in Rome. No thanks. We are quite competent to run our own affairs. And so I think this new structure shows the way towards that and shows the fact that, you know, the Catholic Church is going to be as accommodating as possible without compromising some really fundamental things. To find a way to accommodate you know, Christians of all traditions, really.
You mentioned the dialogue with the Anglican churches and the other Christian churches, but how much attempt has there been with, say, Judaism or Islam or any of the other world religions?
That's very much in a different category of its own. You know, the church distinguishes between kind of ecumenical dialogue and interfaith dialogue, or interreligious dialogue. Dialogue among Christians is going to focus on issues that dialogue with non-Christians it would not make a lot of sense to focus on. In other words, the fundamental point of dialogue among Christians is to find complete Christian unity. The point of dialogue with Muslims and Jews and other traditions in the world is not that, because we're not going to have that in the same way that we hope to have it among Christians. So the point of the dialogue is quite different, in other words, and the questions that are being asked in the dialogue are quite different. But the Catholic Church is in dialogue with everybody. You know, I mean, if you go on the Vatican website, for example, and you look under the Pontifical Council for the Promotion of Christian Unity and the Pontifical Council for Dialogue with the Jews and the Pontifical Interreligious Bodies, and you list the dialogues that are there, I mean, there are many, many dialogues that are listed. So it's an ongoing process. But as I say, the questions and the hoped-for outcomes are different in intra-Christian dialogues versus inter-religious dialogues. Other questions, comments, things you wanted to
Going once.
Adam, you talked about or at least you spent some time talking about the dialogue between the Roman Catholic Church and the Eastern churches, and we touched upon the dialogue between the Catholic Church and the Anglican Communion. But one of the things that the three communions, the Catholic, Roman Catholic Church, the Eastern Orthodox churches, and the Anglican Communion all have in common is the historic episcopacy, the apostolic succession. Now, in other Protestant communions, that is absent. I mean, the differences between the Roman Catholic Church and these other Protestant communions are much more profound, much more pronounced. Where do you see that going, that kind of dialogue, say between Catholics and Lutherans, the Catholic Church, and, say, even evangelical Protestants, that sort of thing?
One of the great sadnesses, I think, of the dialogue in the last 10 years especially has been the great hopes and momentum coming out of Vatican II especially, have really fallen apart because of some developments within Protestant traditions themselves. And so the dialogue in the West that held pride of place for the Catholic Church was precisely the Anglican dialogue, because of the reasons you mentioned, the emphasis upon the historic episcopate and the sacraments and so on, and liturgical tradition. The church after Vatican II really felt that, you know, things were really close with Anglicans, and with a little bit of momentum and a little bit of effort, we could probably heal that breach. Of course, that's in 1965. By 1974, here, 76 in Canada, and later on around the world, Anglicans had started to do a couple of things that nobody had ever seen them doing before. The first was to ordain women. And then some more recent developments around questions of same-sex union and ordination of practicing homosexuals. And so the dialogue that was progressing with such great hopes has, I think, in fact, started going backwards. And it's been very difficult to negotiate and to figure out what to do with that. And so the kind of the diplomatic dances of this week were very interesting to watch. The news conference with the Archbishop of Westminster and the Archbishop of Canterbury, you know, trying to insist that this is we're still friends, even though large numbers of Anglicans might in fact leave us and go join the other side, kind of thing. So these developments, especially on moral issues, not on doctrinal issues per se, or creedal issues per se, have really thrown a wrench in many of these dialogues. And it's become clear, I think, I'm somewhat biased in this regard, but it's become clear that the only dialogue, I think, that has any real success or any real chance of success in the years ahead, barring some dramatic intervention of the Holy Spirit, of course, is the dialogue with the East. The Catholic Church doesn't call anybody a church except the Orthodox. And so that means for, of course, you know, as you know, that it's possible to find your way to salvation because you have access to the sacraments, valid sacraments, and the grace that comes from those. And there's a renewed push for that unity today, both from the Catholic side and, thankfully, after some very difficult periods, from the Orthodox side. And we're starting to realize we really need one another. We're already very close on so many things. And it seems, it's hard to tell right now, but it seems, given the time we're in and what we're facing, that Christians are very, very quickly going to have to get their act together and are no longer going to have the luxury of being divided because of the pressures of secularism, and because, especially in a European context, of the pressures of a resurgent and militant Islam. And Eastern Christians have a lot of experience with that. And I think both sides are realizing if we're going to ever re-evangelize the world, we can't do it except together. And so the dialogue between the Eastern churches and the Catholic Church, I think, is the one that's most likely to bear fruit. Doesn't mean we're going to stop the dialogues with the Anglicans and Lutherans and so on. There's been a lot of progress there, but because of the development of these moral questions in the last couple of decades, those dialogues have really, I think, slowed down. And it's really hard to know what to do with them now. And, you know, Rome is very optimistic in some ways, and I think it's going to continue the dialogue. But it's very clear, I think, beneath the surface that the initial euphoria and momentum coming out of Vatican II has long since died out. And we're in a very, very tough position now to try and, you know, work through new issues. We thought we were united more or less on a lot of the moral questions, and it was some of these bigger doctrinal questions we had to work out. Now we discover we've got the whole thing to try and grapple with, and that just makes things that much more complex.
Thank you, Dr. DeVille.